Good morning, friends. This is the last but one day for us to perhaps say bye-bye. But today we have a very welcome change, perhaps from the kind of our themes which we have been hearing. And we have a very distinguished artist and a scholar of art forms, Mr. Jayaram, with us, who was the former director of the Karnataka Chitrakala Parishad and who will speak on contemporary Indian art and appreciation. But before I introduce him, I would like to introduce Professor P.K. Shetty, who is the chairperson for this morning and who will be with you for the rest of the sessions today. Professor P.K. Shetty, a dear colleague of ours, his interests are biosecurity, agroecology, energy and sustainability, environmental stewardship, science and technology policy studies, and so on. He has worked with many government and non-governmental organizations in the areas of education, environment, and society. He has co-edited two books, published several papers, reports, and articles. He was vice president of Society of Pesticide Science India. He's also a frequently invited speaker at various forums in India and other countries. But the matter of pride for this institute that was that recently he won the Karnataka Rajyotsava Award for Science. May I applaud once again him for that. And he's also a director of the Power Grid Corporation of India. I am also thankful to Professor P.K. Shetty, because when we started thinking about a change in the theme of the course from purely theoretical and academic subjects, Professor Shetty was the person who, you know, forcefully saying that you should look at leadership. That is the theme for the day. And so I'm thankful to Professor Shetty for, you know, bringing this issue once again into the forefront and helping us to design this program. Professor Shetty.
Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta. She remembers certain things which others don't. Thank you so much. Good morning. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Professor Suresh Jayaram, former director, Karnataka Chitrakala Parishad, Bangalore. Professor Suresh Jayaram is a visual artist and art historian. He has a bachelor degree in Fine Arts from the College of Fine Arts, Chitrakala Parishad, Bangalore. For his MA dissertation on K.K. Hebbar, he received the Nehru Small Study Grant. He obtained a Master of Fine Arts degree from M.S. University, Baroda in 1992 in Art Criticism. He has been teaching art history at the Chitrakala Parishad since then. He recently resigned as principal in 2007 and is an independent art consultant. He has exhibited his work individually and in group shows in India at Sakshi Gallery, Samukha Crimson Art Resource in Bangalore, in the India Habitat Center, New Delhi, Appa Rao Gallery, Chennai, the Guild Gallery, Mumbai. He has also curated shows on Indian contemporary art. He was also artist in residency at the Trinity College, Hartford, Connecticut. He delivered an invited lecture at the Total Museum, Seoul, South Korea in 2003. In 2004, the British Council selected him for the Charles Wallace India Trust Award to work at the Gaswork Studio, London. And he is a curator and has organized international workshop with cutting-edge artists in India. He has made corporate presentation on Indian art and culture. He runs an alternative studio residency in Bangalore. His writing have appeared in leading publications such as Art India, Marg, Nandan, Lalitakala Contemporary, and others. He has also written many catalogs for contemporary arts artists. He was also a member of Karnataka Lalita Kala Academy during 2002-2004. He heads the art college in Bangalore as the dean at Chitrakala Parishad, Bangalore. He is the founder trustee of VAC Visual Art Collective, Shanti Road Studio Gallery, which is a trust to promote visual art international residency program and art education. The Studio One Shanti Road has hosted three Fulbright artists and artists from other countries. I now request Professor Suresh Jayaram to deliver his talk.
A very good morning to all of you, and thank you for this very long introduction. And I think I've forgotten my past for some time now. And moving away from academics has put me into this larger world of contemporary Indian art, where, as most of you know, that the art world is booming. And if you're not interested in the art, at least I'm sure you're interested in the economics of art. And currently, as being an advisor for a couple of companies which deal with art, I suddenly realized these new avenues that have opened up, which were unthinkable in the contemporary art situation. I was just telling Sangeeta that somebody came up to me and said that we're opening up a course on arts administration. Another new project was art insurance. And so many new things, and art evaluation. Corporate offices are calling artists to evaluate their corporate collections and create a documentation for them. So it's a new beginning in the contemporary art situation, where not only artists but art historians, theoreticians, etc., are involved in the new dynamics of the visual art, which is really booming in India now. This lecture, I'm sure, will be very visually exciting in the sense that it has a lot of images, some text that will that is self-explanatory. But I'm sure you will enjoy seeing some masterpieces which you might have seen in books, maybe in museums or in private collections. Some of these images which I've chosen are landmarks of contemporary Indian art and modern art. These are very precisely curated together to give you a small glimpse. This is not a holistic art appreciation. It will purely give you a glimpse of important landmarks, works of art that have been created in the past 100 years. So, I'll just start off with the presentation, and just after that, we are open for questions. The most important thing I always believe in and always get bewildered is the diversity of our country. And we cannot have a single history of contemporary Indian art or contemporary Indian culture. It is extremely diverse, it's multiple, it's a polyvalent vision of the world. And in some way or the other, even if you're not involved in the art specifically, you would have encountered art in one way or the other. It could be a small rangoli in front of your house, in your office room, or maybe something which you had to live by, maybe a gift of a print which is there in your wall. But are these art objects, how do these art objects really exist? Do they have a history? Do they have a cultural geography? How do we locate them? The most important thing is to understand that production of art is directly linked with the social, cultural situation of our country. And without art, we would all be, our lives would be very, very dry. When I talk about art, it also means anything from handicraft to decorative arts to most of these things, including painting, sculpture, and architecture. So we'll go by. This is a quote which I like very much by a professor of mine, Ghulam Ahmad Sheikh, who I think indirectly is connected to Mr. Shettar and the Nias at one way or the other. It just talks about the diversity of locating India, in terms of its language, culture, the dynamics of different visual languages that exist in our country, and how do we locate visual art? The most important landmark would be British colonization and what it brought into the dynamics of our country. One very important thing is that it brought in a certain kind of education which was alien to our country. That was a very academic education. Academic education involves a very kind of plural space where artists who belong to different castes, communities come together, like the JJ School of Art, and they all learn visual art, and the syllabus is made in London. So for the first time, artists were doing academic studies, which was not taught earlier. Photography had already entered the Indian scene, and for the first time, things like oil painting, working on canvas, etc. was introduced. The person who comes to our mind at this junction is none other than the father of modern art in India, Ravi Verma. I think he's the most popular, most famous, and most distinguished artist of our country. He is a pan-Indian artist. In any part of India, there will be some aspect of Ravi Verma, either as a calendar or a small image of Saraswati or Lakshmi in your house or in any other form. So Ravi Verma becomes an important landmark for us, coming from the kind of colonial situation where he learned art, traditional art, but later moved on to do this romantic realism, which was what his contribution is. He kind of evoked this kind of glorious past of our country in his works. Involved mythology, and he was also very, very influential in creating a printing press in Lonavala. And this printing press published folios, calendars, etc., which could be distributed in many different places. Another Ravi Verma. The image is quite popular. It's Shakuntala, Kalidasa Shakuntala. Then comes a very important cultural renaissance, the Bengal school. Bengal school for its very revolutionary and consciousness. It's also a place where a lot of thought and art evolved. And Bengal school evolved with a very conscious effort to get back to our Indian roots. So the most important artist is Abanindranath Tagore. Here we see that the artists are rejecting the British kind of influence, the realism, which Ravi Verma was famous for. They are going back to miniature painting, Ajanta as their inspiration. So indigenism became a kind of important revolt against the colonization which persisted in that particular time. So the agenda was back to our roots. How many of you have seen this Bharat Mata? Have you seen this very, very rare image of Bharat Mata? Now I think you see Bharat Mata with a big lion behind her, and she's very aggressive and all that. Here Bharat Mata looks like a Bengali lady, very middle class maybe. She's got extra hands, that's another thing. But it's a very, very very, very spiritual kind of image of Bharat Mata. Almost like Saraswati. You know, so this was consciously created by the influence of Anand Kumar Swami, a very important art critic and historian, Sister Nivedita, who obviously wanted to create a new aesthetic which could sustain the culture and go back to the cultural roots of India. During this time, there was also another important artist like Jamini Rai, who went back to folk art, art of the people. So folk art inspired imagery was also very prevalent. And Jamini Roy is one of the masters of using folk art. Rabindranath Tagore used classical art as a reference, but Jamini Roy goes to folk art. The most significant thing for them to identify with their culture around them. You had other important artists. Many of you might have heard of Shantiniketan, which is the major institute set up by Sri Rabindranath Tagore. And there, some of the important masters like Binod Bihari Mukherjee, Nandalal Bose, etc., they also got back to this whole idea of setting up a Gurukul, where teachers and students share a more intimate relationship. There's a lot of discussion happening, and the space was also very, very convenient for interaction with the other arts, like performing arts especially. A very interesting thing about these small images of very common people doing, like this woman cutting vegetables, etc. It was commissioned by a very important person, and none other than Mahatma Gandhi. He invited Nandalal Bose to decorate the Haripura Congress convention. And the theme that Nandalal Bose took was the working class of India, the masses. We also have other images of Nandalal Bose which explore possibilities of going back to miniature painting, to Ajanta painting, etc. So the language was consciously evolved with references to the past, which was also a problem for them. The criticism they got was that they were not concerned about the political upheaval and the social problems of Bengal. They were more idealists, they were more romantists. So this was the major criticism of a school like the Bengal school. Another great master, Binod Bihari Mukherjee, who created this very elaborate mural of the medieval saints in Shantiniketan. To give you a small, very basic information, a mural painting is something which is in sight. Like it is part of the architecture, it cannot move from one place to another. A painting is something which can move from one place to another because it is in a frame. So murals are created with the architecture in mind, and it has to have a specific theme. Like if I want to have a mural in a hospital, it has to be in specific colors and specific themes which are peaceful, which are happy, etc. So that's the difference between mural and easel format painting. Then the other format is a miniature format painting, which is very small, Mughal miniatures and Rajasthani miniatures, which many of you might have seen in calendars or originals in museums, etc. They are very small, they were largely in folios, and they were looked at as albums. They were not put up on the wall as how we look at them now. So this is the difference between miniature format painting, mural, and the easel format. The easel format is a Western construct, but now we have a long tradition of the easel format painting, and it is part of our culture now, like how English is part of the many languages we speak. Again, part of this very large mural talking about the medieval saints of our country. Another Jamini Roy, you can see how it's very decorative, it's flat, it's not like the realistic images of Ravi Verma. Many of you might have heard about this artist, read about her. She's one of the most famous modern painters, Amrita Shergill. Very, very distinguished parentage. She had an Hungarian mother and a Sardar father. And she lived in Simla, and she's one of the most prominent painters of our times. And she studied in Paris and came back to India in search of her roots. She said she wanted to paint the soul of India. She wanted to experience the poverty, the beauty of her country. She came back to India and she kind of rediscovered herself. She was a very, very beautiful woman. She created many scandals. One of the scandals was that she had a very flirtatious affair with Pandit Nehru, which is kind of recorded in her diary, etc. And those of you who want to hear more, read about her scandalous stories, can read Kushwant Singh's book. If you look at Amrita's paintings, you see that she tries to depict the people of India, the sadness in the women, the kind of confinement they are in, etc. This is what fascinated her coming from Paris. Amrita Shergill was one artist who directly confronted the Bengal school. She told them that there is no essence in the Bengal school. Bengal school was hailed as the national kind of style of India. She said there's no essence, they don't speak about their people, and she was the one who directly talked about them. Then next came the Progressive Artist Group, and I'm sure all of you know who belongs there. An important artist called M.F. Hussain, who you've all heard of, all about. But even if you go and speak to an auto rickshaw driver and ask him who's the most famous artist you know, and he'll say M.F. Hussain. I think he's the most popular artist. And Souza was the ideologue of this particular group. This group was formed in Bombay. And very interestingly, the patrons of this hall, the Tatas, the Parsis of Bombay, were the first patrons of the Progressive Artist Group. They're the ones who bought a lot of paintings, supported these artists, etc. But unfortunately, whenever we talk about Hussain, we only talk about the prizes Hussain gets for his paintings, not about what his work is all about. Souza was a Goan Christian who was a very, very important person to bring the group together. So they created a small group, and their work was very modern. And there was a German scholar and art critic in Bombay called Rudy Van Dyne, who kind of supported them, showed them what expressionistic art was in Europe, etc., which influenced them a lot. The story goes that Ara was a car cleaner in one of the companies. And Hussain found that he could draw very well. He brought him to the group, and Arab went out to become one of the most famous artists in the Progressive group. So this era heralds the modern period of contemporary Indian art. Hussain's most famous painting maybe can be called his magnum opus. It's called Between the Spider and the Lamp, painted in 1956. It's very bold, very expressive. Okay, let's play a small game. What do you think the painting is all about? You can say anything, you can say you don't. The first thing that comes to everybody is, I don't understand art. Okay, let's make an effort to understand art. Any comments, anything? What is it all about? It says, it's got a clue. It says, between the spider and the lamp. There is a lamp here. There's also a spider here. Obviously, there's a group of people around. It's very flat, and there's some kind of a script here which nobody knows what it is except Hussain. Group of people, yes. Sangeeta could give us some clues. There are some gestures here in the painting. So what are these gestures? Mudras. Yeah, they are mudras. Very good. This woman is holding...
I see somebody doing a tilak.
Pardon me, here?
Yeah.
Okay. That's an interesting interpretation.
The thing is so long that the spider has
Okay. It's from my hand, yeah. What is it about the lamp? Okay, it's not an illustrative painting. It does not give you a direct message or a clue, but it's very metaphorical. Hussein is not trying to say anything, but it's a lot of mystery happening over here. Here is a very dominating woman, and she looks like the matron of the house, okay? And she's questioning all these women, 1, 2, 3, 4. And one woman, the woman in yellow, is nude. She's not wearing any clothes. Maybe something happened between the spider and the lamp. The lamps are lit in the night. So something happened in the night. And there's a question about what happened between the spider and the lamp. Nobody knows what happened. Maybe she knows what's happened, and she says, I'm not going to say anything. What is the gesture called in Bharatanatyam? It's a gesture of saying that I'm not going to tell you what I did. So all of you know what happened, hopefully, between the spider and the lamp and the previous night. So here is this woman questioning it. So this is a painting done very, very graphically. There are these two sections. There's some script happening over here. Okay, I'll just move to the next slide. Pardon me? It's one of his most important paintings. Okay, shall I take these questions during the question air session? Yeah. Okay. Another particular genre or style that evolved was self-portraiture. Artists started painting themselves. It is almost like an autobiography. So, I mean, it's very difficult to paint oneself. You have to look at the mirror and find out how you look. Maybe you have a crooked, long nose, but you want to slightly adjust it. But you have to be very honest with yourself to do a self-portraiture. Shergill's representation of herself. Another self-portrait of Shergill. She was very much ahead of her times. She was quite blatant about her sexuality. She did a lot of nudes of her own friends, cousins, etc. And this is a self-portraiture, which is a painting in the nude. Another important artist called Bhupen Kakkar. You might have heard of him. He's from Gujarat and a very important artist because he refers to popular culture. Popular culture meaning calendar art, etc., to his work. And here is a painting which talks about narration. He says, you can't please all. So it's a story, Aesop's fable. And here is the artist himself standing there saying, you can't please all. So story and narration became part of the contemporary art situation. There's also this new trajectory that formed in the contemporary art situation that was a certain kind of conscious effort to relate to the roots, especially of the tribal and folk cultures of our country. This was another group that evolved, and this group was called 1890. Those of you who are familiar with Bhopal and Bharat Bhavan know that J. Swaminathan was responsible for setting up this cultural organization. He was also responsible for putting together of folk and tribal art, which was a very important segment, an Adivasi artist segment as part of contemporary art practice. No, it was just the door number of the artist who was living there. So they said, let's call it 1890. Swaminathan's work, inspired by folk and tribal art. Pardon me? Okay, I think this is a very common question of what is it? I don't have to answer it, you've just answered it all. I think beyond that there is nothing else. It is talks about water, maybe the fish, reflections of the mountains, a bird soaring in the yellow sky. One more mountain is floating. This is the freedom artists have. You just have to accept what we do, you know. Like, you don't have an option. You can't question it. Okay, the work is inspired by primordial nature. It talks about the elements of the earth, water, air, and earth. And it has no human beings in it, so it talks about a very, very kind of ancient space. And it's just flat, decorative. This is the artist's language. You can accept it or totally reject it. And if you like it, you might as well buy it. Maybe it'll cost you a couple of crores, but that's another story. In the south, we had another group called the Cholamandal Artist Group, which was set up in outskirts of Chennai. Now it's become part of Chennai. Cholamandal Artist Group was set up by KCS Panikkar, another very distinguished scholar, an artist who put this group together to set up art which can relate to people, art which people can buy, can live with, etc. So the arts and crafts came together. I think the most two distinguished thing is that I don't understand this modern art, but I like what is being sold in Kaveri Emporium, right? So I'm not distinguishing it. Even that is a form of part of our culture. But it has different ways of producing it. A work of art by an artist is unique. A handicraft is kind of produced in multiples. He called it words and symbols. So it could be an astronomical chart, it could be Rangoli patterns, it could be a Malayalam script all over the place. And he became the most distinguished artist, again to kind of go back to the Dravidian culture, back to the southern culture, southern cultural history. And the group of artists around him, some of the most distinguished of them, S.G. Vasudeva, local artist, Balan Nambiar, all of them were somehow or the other influenced by this great personality. Another of Panikkar's... I can read something. It says, metaphor of picture making. So it's like algebra. It's like signs, symbols, algebra. Just what it is. It is nothing beyond that. It could be diagrams. It could be column patterns. It could be scribbles, graffiti, and all that. Another very distinguished man, K.G. Subramaniam, from the south, but bridges Shantiniketan on one side and M.S. University Baroda on the other. Subramaniam started again going back to different kinds of material. He said that material is very important, so he worked with material which suggested the folk or different cultural aspects. He started doing glass painting, started doing terracotta murals. Now, what is this all about is another story. Is like he was, it says generals and trophy, directly relating to the Bangladesh war. Here are photographs of, I mean, images of grinning generals. And here are these bodies hanging upside down. It has a connection with the Bangladesh war. So artists are not only people who do decorative things which you can put up in your drawing room or in your foyer, etc. They're not just pretty pictures. They could be a reflection of society. They could show a mirror to you, telling you that you belong to this world, which is cruel, which is happy, which is sad, etc. So they are commentators of our world, our life, etc. Another of Subramaniam's terracottas. Subramaniam believed a very interesting way of being an artist. He said he was the dean of MSU University, Baroda, and he says that I will relate to different people in different ways. To a child, I'll make a toy which he can play with. For a grown-up, I'll make a book. And for the art connoisseur, I'll make paintings. So he said an artist has to be multidimensional. He should illustrate books, he should make objects, murals, etc. He believed art should be part of the public domain. Like most of us know, and it is a fact that art is very elitist. And most of us don't make the effort to understand it. Art is elitist, only rich people can buy it. But there are a lot of ways which you can just appreciate art. You don't need to own art. You could appreciate the aesthetics of art. Look at what material it is made up of, the lines, colors, the textures of it, etc. Here is another artist who worked with hemp. She was a student of K.G. Subramaniam. Hemp is nothing but kind of a rope. And she created these huge, massive sculptures using craft of weaving. She just macrame. She made these huge, massive sculptures which are 10 foot high. Runalini Mukherjee. You can see an image of Yakshi. Post 1970s, you have a particular institution in a city becoming very, very prominent. That is MS University, Baroda. I also belong to this university, and most of you might have experienced or seen in the news of the kind of things that happened in the MS University. There was a lot of problems regarding censorship. What kind of art should be exhibited? And why should the public be involved or allowed to come into an examination? So this is another story, but it's very important to know that MSU University became one of the most distinguished university because of its theoretical base. It has one of the best archives in the country. It has Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh, K.G. Subramaniam, N.S. Bendre, Dr. Parimu. All of them are the founders of this particular college. And the Maharaja Sayaji Rao, who established this university, and one of the few universities in the country where education for women is free from the nursery to whichever part. They only pay very, very nominal fee or whatever. It's free education. And strangely enough, those of you who don't know about it, the great philosopher and revolutionary Sri Aurobindo was also taught in the MS University. And he was an English professor there, and he also worked for the Maharaja. The artists of this particular generation believed in talking about their locality, getting back to their own histories, personal stories, etc. So figuration and narration became a very important tangent for expressing themselves. So people like Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh referred to Persian miniatures, Mughal miniatures, etc. There were a lot of other artists who explored different possibilities of looking at our own tradition, where narration was a very significant part. Narration because of, it could be Ajanta, it could be where the story of Buddha is narrated, it could be Mughal miniatures where other stories are narrated. So the title says Speaking Tree. It just is an overhead view of a street where many things are happening simultaneously. Here a man is beating up his wife. There is a couple making love in the next house. There's a man praying in the Dargah. There are angels who have descended from heaven right on top over there. And this is the speaking street. It's just like India. Simultaneous things happening everywhere. Simultaneous narration. And the autobiographical content became very important for this artist. They said, we need to speak about ourselves. Nobody's going to write your story, so you have to tell your own story. Another of Ghulam Bhai's work. This is a city which has been sieged. It's like a riot. Nobody is there. Everybody has disappeared. Only crows and dogs. Another artist from Mumbai, but connects to this particular group called Nalini Malani. She talks about her own surroundings, the people around her, her own family, and the growing up girl, the girl child. This is Professor Subramaniam's work. Depicts a woman and a cat to try and discover other meanings. A cat has always been a symbol of sexuality. And a woman, here a woman is looking back at you again. She's in the interior space, and there's this large flower arrangement in front of her. Pardon me? The cat is a symbol of sexuality. It is her pet. The cat almost looks human. It's grinning back at you. Here is a blind mother and child. Interestingly, the inspiration for this is Tanjo painting. There's a lot of gold behind, and the glass painting of southern India. Here is the other artist from the Baroda school who's created this work called Celebration of Guru Jayanti. It's very obvious there is Guruji sitting here being honored, etc. The group of men and this typical Gujarati village in the background. Another of Bhupen's work where many things are happening around him, and here is a portrait of a man. Very ironically, he's having a bouquet of plastic flowers. Flowers which are never going to fade. So we have another section from the figurative to the narration, etc. We have another section called abstraction. And here is a situation where most of you have to enjoy it for its texture, color, line, form, etc., without any context of reference to reality. If you look at the paneling around you, it's just lines. So you might see some images which might not make any sense to you, but are just purely formal expressions which the artist works with. Very famous artist, Raza. Now what, but some of them have some symbolism. For some of you, it might look like a cushion cover, right? Some of you might, it looks like a clock without the handles. But for Raza, it is called the Bindu. It's inspired by the cosmic bindu where everything, like a black hole, where everything dissolves into this black hole and everything emerges from this black hole. Another of Raza's bindus. It's purely design. It's and sometimes it has symbolic meaning, like bindu, as I said. So each color also has specific symbolic meaning. It has triangles, squares, elemental forms, circles, square, triangles. And many of the paintings have this thing called untitled. That is the mystery of the artist. You have to decipher what it is. It's a challenge for all you viewers. Another of Raza's painting is purely color, the color he experienced in the forests of Madhya Pradesh, exploding color like the heat of the sun, etc. So it is just layers and layers of color, pure abstraction. Another artist, so you have multiple interpretations. Each one of you can interpret it differently. What does it look like? Yes. Lotus. It's also the light within, like the light which one experiences when during meditation. An exploding light, slowly moving and expanding. Another artist, Nasreen, who just did these beautiful pencil lines. It might just evoke wind, water, etc. The small, thin pencil lines drawn for almost days on end. It might resemble the wood panel in front of you, but it is an artist's abstraction of a reality. It doesn't mean anything, it's purely lines. And in that lines, you see a certain rhythm, like music, there's a certain rhythm. Another famous artist who just believed, you saw line and here is and you also saw color in Raza, and here is pure texture. Texture which has no meaning, but texture which is looks like growth of fungus or walls which have been wet for many, many days, etc. Layers and layers of colors. Very meditative, it some might resemble a landscape or a seascape, etc. Pardon me? Baba was his major patron. Homi Baba collected a lot of Gaitonde's work because he's very fond of this artist. This is Jayaram Patel, who is another abstract artist. Here, there the form looks as if it's about to explode any time. Ambiguity is another aspect of abstraction. Here it looks like there's something happening in a big black sack and it's about to explode. This is after the explosion, maybe. It looks like parts of bodies, mechanical parts, etc. But the artist is not giving you any clues. Another work of art which you might try to interpret. What does it look like? Is it a design?
What is the human body doing?
here is G.R. Santosh, who has this meditating, geometric abstraction of the human body meditating. It's got the third eye, which is suddenly opened. And it's like in Padmasana. Yes, yes. Another image. This is the union of Shiva and Shakti. I have a very separate section called Women Artists. I can see very few of them here, but there are a lot of them there in the art world. And they have special things to say to us. So I want to ask you a question. Should a woman's expression and art be different from a man's expression in art? Yes? Yes.
Well, if somebody said that men are from Mars and women from Venus, there has to be some difference.
No, I think it will differ, because typically they say men think with their heads and women think with their hearts.
Very true. Gender plays a very important role in the way things are expressed. So women have their own stories, women have their own aspirations. Women also have special experience, like motherhood, etc., which is only can be experienced by them, not by men. Here is Rekha Rodvitya, an artist who's very, very vocal, feminist artist. She says that women have some things to say. Here, a woman is almost red. Red, obviously, being the color of revolution. She's almost dismantling everything around her. And there are all these objects. There is this yin-yang symbol, which is a symbol of male and female. There are these architectural objects. Aeroplane, talking about symbol of travel and architecture. The woman is emerging out of it. She slightly dismantled this man. She's kind of in the background. And the title says Shedding of Innocence. Another artist who uses women's craft which is used by women, largely women, domestic craft like embroidery, knitting, etc., and creates this image. But in this kind of netted kind of sculpture, she uses human bones as an armature, as a structure. So she says that bodies are covered with beautiful clothes, but inside them, when we die, we are all bone. Anita Dubey. This is Navjot Altaf talking about the girl child. It says, I have no fate lines. I think there's a wrong title over there. Here is a small girl child holding a hand. It's very expressively painted blue and red. And the sculpture is on the floor. Another famous artist from Delhi talking about the plight of women. And she has a lot of series on the widows of Vrindavan, the ecological problems, etc. She talks about issues that women address. Women also express their anguish, their hopes, etc., to their works. Here's a series from the widows of Vrindavan. Most of you might have heard about the widows of Vrindavan, this very cruel custom of abandoning widows in Vrindavan in these small ashrams. where they think Krishna, the Lord, is going to come and help them out or appear to them, etc. It's a belief, and it's also a social custom. And here are these women in white, and this is the imaginary Krishna on the banks of the Yamuna. Quite illustrative and very direct. It does not have metaphors, etc., like how Hussein has. This is a very interesting image. Maybe I invite anybody to interpret it from the audience? Juggler plays with you. Yes? Various roles men play in society.
He is a procurer.
Yeah. It's architecturally divided, so there are all these women. And here is a man who is the master manipulator, the patriarch. And he's juggling with this woman. He's almost holding her in the tip of her finger. He'll just flick her and she'll just start floating. Obviously, talks much about Indian society. Another interpretation, Gogi Saroj Pal. I don't need to explain it, right? But now she's trying to twist the equation. Here is the goddess who was in the previous image very docile like an animal. It suddenly become Shakti. She's dancing on the tiger. The tiger looks like a small cat. This is again an image from Indian Durga, image of Durga. And she's also doing Hatha Yoga on the cat. And here is a painting which is very interesting. The woman animal is no longer very docile. She's also manipulating him. She's quite aware that here is a man who's trying to ride her. But she's trying to negotiate her strength, her abilities also. This painting was called Swayamvar. You can see the garland. Here's another artist, Mrinalini Mukherjee, who has reinterpreted all of you might have seen the Shiva Nataraja. Here's a Nataraja which is does not have that big Prabhavali, and the rhythm is very, very beautiful, dancing in abandon. The most important aspect of it is done by this particular material called Dokra casting. Dokra casting is a craft from Bastar in Madhya Pradesh. There is no boat, but just by the gesture of the man, you can see that he's a boatman. A painting that kind of had problems with the censorship, Arpita Singh from Delhi, who created this Durga for the cover of this very famous Bengali magazine called Desh, which on every Durga Puja, it invites artists to interpret Durga in a different way. And here is a contemporary Durga. And what do you see in her hand? And does the body under Durga resemble a popular image? The body and the Durga here. Here is a man coming, descending into the composition with a knife. Durga is holding a gun. Very strangely, yeah? Yes, very good. The assassinated Rajiv Gandhi's body was found like this. and obviously was killed by this woman. So very, very artists interpret things and sometimes land into trouble, like our friend Mr. Hussein, who's in Dubai and not coming back to India. Here is another interpretation of Durga. It's very playful, almost childlike, by an artist called Madhavi Parekh, who is untrained, but her husband is an artist, Manu Parekh. So she's taken up painting, and most of her images have these very childlike, joyous images of a utopian celebration. We go to another section called realism, and realism directly connects to the world around us and the media around us. Nothing can be more real than a photograph. So you have artists referring to the reality around them, the poverty. Here is a scene behind the circus. How am I doing on time? Yeah, some more slides. A slice of reality of a Bombay train. And there's a conversation happening here. There's a man waiting here. There's a woman standing here. Maybe there's something happening between both of them. Sudhir Patwardhan, incidentally, he's a doctor, but one of the most distinguished painters of our country today. And his subject is the reality of Bombay. The crowd of a city. Another artist who works with realism is Bikash Bhattacharji from Bengal. Stark realities, poverty, very, very real, very, very direct. Ajay Desai and Natraj Sharma depicting urban reality. A paan ka dukaan here, inside of a crowded bus. The artist is from Bangalore, so you can imagine. Is another young artist painting a circus. More direct, more real. You have another extension of this realism, where there's a lot of photorealism. And images are not directly connected to India, but can be a collage of images seen in National Geography or the media, etc. It's called mediatic realism. Middle class reality, the inside of a domestic space. Another artist, Atul Dodia, the same artist, has got Mahatma Gandhi walking into a gallery. So they create their own reality. It didn't happen. Mahatma Gandhi never went into this gallery, but he takes the image of Gandhi and places it in this gallery. Paints his own father on a rolling shutter. Another series of Mahatma Gandhi on the rolling shutter. Another contemporary artist going back to the kind of folk and traditional art. These huge sculptures, almost 10 feet in height. They are like goddesses who attract and repel you at the same time. Other realities, the different kind of divergent horizon which is seen in contemporary art. sculpture. It's an image done by an artist who works in a suitcase. So he has different objects in a suitcase, and you open one of the suitcases, you have this, it's not a real hen, it's a stuffed hen, suddenly bewildered by this golden egg. Another suitcase has this fish, and as soon as you touch this fish, there's a device which, it starts speaking. Pardon me? Speaking to the BBC. He works in small suitcases so he can carry these things and display them anywhere in the world. Here is an artist who did a very interesting work which cannot be bought or sold. He did posters. And anybody who can read Malayalam, the translation is how to draw a line without dots. So here is a So what does it mean? Here is the finger of the artist with the mark, the dot which kind every voter gets. So how do we have a country without voters? How do we have a country without people? So he did these posters and stuck it in different parts of Kerala during the election time. So people thought it's a new party. So an artist also plays with society in different ways, where the work of art need not be in the gallery, but out in the public domain. Thank you, open for questions and a dialogue.
Thank you, Professor Jayaram, for your wonderful presentation. Figurative narration, abstract, and presentation of the work of women artists, realism, really delighted us this morning. Now the session is open for discussion.
Jayaram, I had only one, of course, as we went through, many thoughts flew across as you flipped one view graph, one slide to another. But okay, each one had its own impression on me, specifically, personally. So I, as appreciation of art and all that, whatever you have been trying to tell us, I just couldn't make out anything on the Kissa Aziz Azizaka, that is your Ghulam M. Sheikh's
thing. Yes, yes.
As an art appreciator, could you give your thoughts on that?
Okay, most of the time it's very important to understand what goes behind the artist's when he paints this particular image. So this particular image which I've chosen is about from Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh, and it comes from a Persian story. So it is a story of Aziza, Aziz and Aziza. So the story talks about the torture of Aziza. There were some torturous images in the center of the image. This particular style brings where the artist is trying to narrate particular stories which are connected to his own reality. So the story is about Aziza and Aziz. So and the, in the figurative narrative style, many stories are narrated, and they use the format of a painting to narrate stories. Some of them also make short films, video films, etc.
I have one question for you, Professor Shetty. And this is more because, you know, okay, the course of this type where, you know, we are supposed to get, relate so many things, so-called excellence in leadership. And in the introduction, Dr. Sangeeta told that you were one of the persons who looked at how to modify the structure of the course and all that. Now, I was just trying to find your thoughts. Okay, we will have our own thing, but what were the underlying thoughts for you to include this presentation from an artist's perspective to such an audience as part of the course of excellence in leadership?
This is a very good question. You know, in fact, we have been trying with various themes earlier. You know, earlier when we started with the course for senior executives, we used to say integrated approach to knowledge and information. Couple of years, you know, we tried with different themes. But 4 years back, when actually we were discussing which theme would be the better, I suggested to the institute that we should have the theme on leadership. So actually various aspects of leadership. I feel, you know, we need to have good leaders, not only in science, we need to have good leaders in all the disciplines. So that is why, you know, we will get an opportunity to learn from the leaders how they excelled in different fields. And also it is an opportunity for all of us to learn from them. So that is our interest. In a way, we are also, you know, making you all leaders in some forms. That is the interest. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Maybe it was quite a good presentation, since most of the time we never give much attention to an art thing. So now at least 1 hour we were able to know something. My question is, why do we say modern art and a contemporary art? Contemporary, I can understand, people living at the same period of time. Every time if you look, it is a contemporary. Modern art means something, what is modern actually? That's what I want to know. Do you have a definition, or is it just called modern art? Contemporary, okay. People and the same period of time, you can say contemporary art. That is one question. The second one is, what makes the art pieces highly expensive, particularly when it is neither understood nor it is complex? What is the greatness in this, and why it is priced at such a high this thing?
I'll take your first question. Modern belongs to a particular period. If we try to locate ourselves now, we belong to the postmodern situation. We are not in a modern world. Modern was when we were modernized. Post-romanticism or during the colonial time, we were all modernized. So the time during the colonial time and the art which was created at that particular junction till the independence is considered modern, that time frame. After that, post-independence era, modern still continues, and then we have a kind of shift, and we also say contemporary. You say contemporary, it's about artists who are still living, existing, working around us, etc. Contemporary, the definition to give you is the here and now. So to differentiate between the modern as a particular period, which could involve the Nehruvian era, it could be involve pre-independence period, etc. British colonization is considered modern. Back to this, very difficult question about why art is so expensive, why certain works of art are more expensive than the other. The question can be answered in only one way. Art and appreciation is different from the art market. The art market is a very, very complex situation. The people who are involved in the art market are dealers, art galleries, and artists themselves. So how an artist is marketed depends upon the media, depends upon the people around the artist, and how one artist is projected and the other artist is totally neglected. I want to give you the example of Van Gogh, the most famous artist of last century, who never sold a single painting. The only painting he sold was the painting bought by his own brother to kind of encourage him. And after he died, about 4 or 5 years ago, one of his paintings was sold in a Sotheby or Christie auction for millions of dollars. Van Gogh is not going to get that money, nor will his family. Some dealer or buyer who has got that work of art is going to get it. The art market is very vicious. It's like any other business. It's almost synonymous with the stock market. One artist is projected, the other artist is not. So there's a lot of media hype around artists. And art has become more expensive. In the contemporary situation, the art market has really boomed. Like artists are fetching astronomical prices. Here the market is a different thing. I can't explain how the reasons for this is purely business, media hype, and artists trying to play up to the galleries, etc. A Hussein painting is measured by square inch rate, like land or property. And somebody else might not get the same kind of thing. It is how the artist remains in the news, how the artist is popular in the popular imagination of people.
Yeah, thank you.
Raghunath from LRD Bangalore. I found this exposure to this lecture was very intellectual, stimulating. And it has brought into a technical, you know, we are from technical background. They are much more than technical things. Sometimes I feel technical subjects are nothing compared to when you talk about this, the way you bring out the type of things which are there. Especially we do take back certain things, translate this into our domain in terms of certain very important aspects of this entire lecture series what you have done. Sir, I have one or two small thing. One is, what happens to this intellectual property right when it comes to the art? Are we permitted to take this type of a projection which you have done? Are we permitted to do this type of projection somewhere else, like some of our meeting, any other place? Are we permitted to project this one? Second, are we permitted to take a print also on this type of, after you have done this type of projection, there are always now prints are there. Are we permitted to take this? Then suppose we need a print, I suppose we need to project Ravi Verma's thing or any of Hussein's painting. How do we go about in handling this situation? This is one question. Second is, sir, you're told when the artist does, it takes a lot of time for him to come out with the painting. What exactly he will be doing during this long period? Is he conscious about, the artist is conscious, or it is some sort of fifth sense or sixth sense, his mind is sixth sense and the thing. And what happens to his personal life as an artist when this type of things are? Third is how the family accepts the artist.
Can it be a little brief because we have four questions and we have only 10 minutes
and,
to do.
Third is we have a lot of Ajanta and Ellora type of painting, lot of heritage type of things were done earlier. Anything is done to keep this thing alive in terms of the type of painting they have used, paint they have used. They say those days it's all made of organic vegetable things and then how do we estimate the cost of a painting? What method is done? Third, last thing, sir, if there is a Hussein painting, if it is not known, it is, suppose we erase it as Hussein, without the thing, can we identify it as Hussein's painting or valid?
Okay, I'm floored with these questions. Anyway, I'll start from the beginning, talking about property rights. Okay. The artist owns the copyright. You can display the work, you can show an image, but in case you print this particular image and put it up in your office, the artist can come and demand money from you. And if you can't afford to buy an artist's work, you can always go to the Lalit Kala Academy or the Chitrakala Parishat in Bangalore or any other academy and buy a print of the artist which has been published. And this you can put up on your wall. There's a lot of intellectual and property rights problems with folk art here, folk and tribal art. Yeah, that cannot be sorted out. But here, the copyright of each individual work, which is a unique work, there is no second, is with the artist, or if the collector has bought a particular work, it belongs to the collector. The collector can sell the rights for publishing that particular work.
The second question is regarding how long the artist takes. An artist can take 5 minutes to do a painting. It can take, a month to do a painting. Time cannot be a guarantee for a masterpiece, but it is his creative ability to create a work of art. And what is he trying to say in that particular time? Regarding the personal life of an artist, artists, as most of you know from the media, are difficult people. And the families, my family is adjusted to me and my very erratic ways of living. So I think each individual is different, and each individual has, but what the artist enjoys is this total freedom of expression, the total freedom of living the way he wants to live. And that is his greatest asset. And obviously, many things fall apart, but there are ways of negotiating, like in any other profession, etc. Another thing about how a work of art is kind of rated and prized, etc., which you said, there is different ways the market relates to a work of art. The artist, his total oeuvre, like the number of years he has worked, his credentials of being in the public domain, his contribution in terms of his art and creativity. And now you have the other ways of calculating it according to the market, the way market does it, according to the square inch rate or according to his talent or whatever. The last section of the question is about Ajanta, which I think Ajanta painting is, as you know, 5th and 6th century, and it was done in a particular time frame. We cannot replicate it. Only thing we can do is protect it. And the only way to do it is that we can create in the other medium Ajanta paintings, and the Archaeological Survey of India is doing all its best to protect these monuments. It also has Japanese technicians to kind of protect these monuments, and even camera flashes are not allowed inside. Even your breath, even if your breath is going to affect the paintings in future, the amount of carbon dioxide produced in a cave with these paintings around is going to affect the paintings. Nothing lasts forever, but if you have an heritage which you can preserve, you might as well preserve it.
Thank you. I appreciate the spirit of Raghunathan asking question. I think that is what Niyas appreciates. Because of shortage of time, we may not able to take all the questions. What I suggest is we will take all the questions. I will request speaker to respond to it. Can we do that?
Yeah. Do you foresee the computer graphics?
We'll take all the questions first, then he will respond.
Please be brief. Only one sentence. Do you believe that computer graphics will all the innovation of being a painter or artist?
I feel computer graphics is an extension of an artist's hand. I mean, there is a mind behind even the computer, in the sense that if I want to create a certain kind of effect, I need to use my brains to decide what kind of effect I need. For an artist, it is a challenge to work beyond a computer.
I have 2 questions. I have only 2 questions. One is, I never exposed to or discussions with any artist in my life so far, except this is the first time I came across, because this is the subject which is totally abstract to me. So I concentrately I was listening to you, whatever you said. Two things I wanted from the same fundamental doubts I have. See, an art, the painter, whichever he gives, should convey a meaning, that it should be a self-explanatory. It is not that unless until you explain it, I'll understand it. Otherwise, only an artist can appreciate another artist. A common man cannot appreciate an artist. Because you are an artist, you know the colors, which color represents what and all that. So you are able to tell this represents angry, this like that. I cannot understand anything. And modern art is something which goes in strokes. I think I am not able to appreciate anything in that, why it is appreciated by many people. Only 2 things I appreciated is Ravi Verma's painting, which you have shown first. That is the best. I like such things only. whole civilization can be depicted in such manner, in a correct way. And reality, realism or realism, you showed those things like that. Paintings, why it cannot be done so that people appreciate the various civilizations, various things. That is one. Next is, you are not shown M.F. Hussein or your paintings. I don't know why.
Okay, my question is that...
Yeah, just one second. You know, as part of the leadership, we look at nurturing talent. So we identify sports people at a fairly early age and sponsor that particular, you know, person. So whether it is archery or cricketers or football, we have got academies to support and promote that particular person's talent. I just wanted to understand from you that, is it possible to identify budding painters, you know, who display certain talent fairly early age, and then sort of spend the time with them, sponsoring them in a certain way, and then launch them? Because I really do not know what is the way to launch a certain artist, because it is, many ways they are puppets in the hands of galleries and a very close coterie which is around it. But there is a lot of talent which sits, like Bengal is full of, you know, such talent, and we just do not know how to go about it. So if you could share some of your thoughts on that subject, it would be really nice.
Yeah, two questions. You started your presentation with post-colonial. What about prior to that in India? Are we to take that just like everything is claimed that after the British came only it has been discovered, like Ajanta was discovered by the British or something like that? So can you comment on the status before that? Second question is, when an artist paints, does he have a unique explanation or theme when he is painting, or after painting he leaves it to the imagination of the viewer?
Mani from the Department of Science and Technology. First of all, I thank Dr. Suresh for the colorful and most attractive presentation of the entire course. My question is relates to the leadership. Why do some paintings are objectionable and create a crisis for leadership, like M.F. Hussein's paintings? Either the artist is lacking the understanding of the sentiments of the people, or the people don't understand the art. And why M.F. Hussein is required to be away? It happens in writers also. Taslima and Nasreen can't, she doesn't know where to stay now. And it happened during Ramlila. People dance disco to enact the Ramayana. Why does this happen? And number two, our leadership involvement in art and culture is very much required for maintaining peace and tranquility in the entire country. I strongly feel that it is essential. It happened during the ancient time. All our kings, they were appreciating art and culture. They were deeply involved in that. You can take fine example of Jawaharlal Nehru appreciating the music of M.S. Subbulakshmi. So what do you comment on that?
Thank you.
Yeah, just two questions. It is said that art is for art's sake because it has no relevance to the society. Your comments on that. And second is, why nudism is so explicit in almost all the paintings? Does it reflect the mental aberration of the painter? These are the two questions.
You know, this in the course of art appreciation, the critics and those people who are collectors, they often try to define the art or interpret the art in many forms. And the viewer also has his own definition. It's perfectly fine. But what probably we all miss out in the course is the mind of an artist. We very rarely brought out in the criticisms that we come across. So why this is so? Except maybe some old, you know, biographies like Agony and Ecstasy and all that. But they are fictitious also a little bit. I want you to say something on that.
Okay, everybody is curious about what happens behind the scenes. How do these artists live? I mean, what's happening in their crazy minds? Do they have normal lives? Do they eat upma, idli, dosa like you and me? I mean, artists are like you and me. Only thing is that they have special capabilities. The most important capability has been their freedom of expression. They don't care a damn for anybody. They think that freedom of expression is the most potent weapon for an artist. He can do anything. He can stand upside down and tell you, if you want to accept me like that, please do. If you don't like it, don't look at me. So it's, and he also says that if you don't understand, I mean, back to your question, you say that I don't understand art, I liked Ravi Verma. Fantastic. At least you like Ravi Verma. The thing is that when you go to a music concert, you don't know all the ragas, you don't know all the intricacies of music. But in case you want to understand the whole intricacy of a classical music concert, you have to do your homework. So for that, one has to understand the fundamentals of visual art. The fundamentals of visual art could be line, color, form, texture, the theme of the artist, etc. So if we do a little bit of homework, I think art will come closer to us and it'll enrich our lives. And if we, but if we say that I only understand Ravi Verma, it's a very subjective thing, and it's good that you like realism because it is more direct to you. But the other artists also have a certain validity. So they say that abstraction is also another language which is beyond realism, like the different languages of our country. Back to the talent and sponsorship of young artists, there are many institutions, many individuals supporting the arts. But in a large country like India, it's not really enough. There's always a need for support for artists. What is happening is that identification of talent is very crucial. It can happen in the education system itself. Art need not be just one period for a young student where he will be creative. He has to be creative constantly. So it's an important thing to do is to introduce art into, not art into education, but make art part of education. Make creativity a part of other forms of education. If you're talking about Mughal period, you can show them Mughal miniatures, you can show them Mughal jewelry, costumes, etc. What stops you from doing that? The problem with us is that our teachers are not very creative. They stick to the syllabi and they just want to finish the course so that they'll be ready for the exams. But the ways of contacting or supporting artists is to send them to some kind of art schools, support them at that initial period, and don't hold them always and nurture them, because they need to find their own way. The best way to do is that they need to do computer graphics to support their visual art, or do teaching to support their visual art. So help them initially, and maybe also help teach them how to fish. Back to post-colonial thing. I mean, India has a long heritage of visual art. I had a limitation, so I just started off from the British times during colonization and Ravi Verma. Before colonization, there was a long history of Indian painting, sculpture, architecture, which most of you are familiar with, from Ajanta to the sculptures of Ellora, Taj Mahal, you name it. And we have a large variety of cultural artifacts. Art was part of our reality. It was not something unique in a museum or a gallery. It was part of our own reality. We lived with art. We had beautiful things to use, etc. Even a comb used to be made very artistically. And so art and society was very much connected. Post-colonial rule, there was a great divide. They said that this is handicraft and that is art. So if you are an artist who goes to an art college, you become an artist. But if it's your mother doing rangoli, it's not considered art, it's considered something else. So there was this long history which I'm unable to show you. Maybe there's another opportunity I can give you the course of art history that happened in our country. Very, very diverse. You also asked about the theme of the artist, right? What's in his mind? Themes are very subjective. And so the artists consciously uses specific themes that are closer to his art. It could be a self-portraiture, or it could be commenting on women's issues, like the women artists you saw, or it could be something very abstract, like Mr. Razav or others, who said it looks like light emerging, or it's just a black dot. So each artist has a specific theme, style, etc., which he wants to engage in, and that becomes his kind of signature style. For that matter, Hussein is famous for his horses. So that is his signature style. He also painted a lot of Indian themes, etc. Which again leads to my next question about art and censorship. I think...
Professor Suresh Jayaram, sorry to interrupt. As you can even discuss
in the break.
In the tea time, as you have to start next session by 11:30, I would like to request you to be a little brief.
Okay. Back to... somebody said, talked about censorship. There is an obvious mass appeal of artists, and the mass or the people try to have objections with the artists. The artists at least have the freedom to express certain things. When the censorship comes because of a certain public, in a public domain, when these things are exhibited in a public domain, that a lot of problems happen during that particular time, especially M.F. Hussein. Pardon me?
Reasonable restriction on the freedom of the artist.
There is
just because he has a lot of freedom, he should not see.
Let us have a parallel discussion
over the tea. Again, this long during tea, I can explain to you about Hussein controversy. It's another story, and things for. Somebody asked about nudity, why there's so much nudity in the arts. I think why there's so much nudity in Indian films also. Maybe that just proves a point. Nudity is very subjective. People have objections to it, but many people like it. And the other last thing was about the mind of the artist. I think it's the most complex mind. The mind of the artist in the popular imagination that it is very creative, he's a free artist, etc. But he has also, I mean, existential problems, I mean, survival difficulties. Sustainability is the greatest problem for an artist. How is he going to sustain himself as a creative individual, as part of the complex situation of living in a society, being part of society's need for art, which is part of our culture. So contemporary artist also plays an important role to, enrich our culture, enrich our lives in many different ways. It could be an advertising, it could be an image on the wall, it could be an idol for Durga Puja, or it could be something else, which you could use as a decorative object. So to sum it up all, that it is very difficult to live without artists. It is also very difficult to live without art. And life and culture without art would make it a very, very dull place. Thank you.
One question you have not answered. Your paintings and Hussein paintings.
My paintings, another session. You can come to my house if you are in Bangalore. I'll show you all my paintings.
No request. Virendra Kumar to present word of thanks, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'll start from Mr. Raghunath's question yesterday during Mr. Vijay Kelkar's lecture, that how our soft values are going to be preserved, including our culture, heritage, etc. So, fine arts, combination of contemporary art and visual art is a very, very viable means of preservation of our culture and our values as well as our heritage. That I think you all would agree with me. As far as the linkage of this topic to leadership is concerned, I can only quote and give my experience that when I was a kid of about 6 years age, M.F. Hussein was staying somewhere close by, and he used to use the same road in New Delhi. One thing which made him popular even at that time, when he was, I think, probably in his early 30s only, was his old Vauxhall painted all over. I think the Indian regulation or the RTOs at that time did not even permit painting of a car, and he had a car which he used to move around up and down on the roads of Delhi. And everybody would say, oh, look, from our school, everybody would say that here, M.F. Hussain is going, M.F. Hussain is going. Most of us got to know M.F. Hussain only the post Madhuri Dixit era, and thereafter started appreciating his paintings. But I think he was a leader right from the very beginning, and he had left his mark at a very early age, which probably most of us were not aware of. Next is connected with the theme of our course, two important traits of a leader, that is creativity and appreciation, I think go hand in glove with fine arts and contemporary art. Most of us have missed out these two important facets during the course of our career, which was quite evident from the interaction we had in the during the question hour. And I think a stage has come for us now to at least appreciate, if not create, contemporary art, or if we are not able in a position to create it, at least the appreciative stage for each one of us has come, and hence the importance of this lecture, for which I am extremely grateful to Dr. Sangeeta Menon for scheduling it on our course. It's only that Dr. Suresh Jayaram has, I think, brought about this awareness amongst us at this age of our service and life. And I think it's very important, because now is the time that one can devote, and it will open further vistas for us to further educate ourselves on this subject. A very, very nicely put across lecture by the doctor, and on behalf of each one of us, a vote of thanks as well as for the doctor. As also, I must thank the chairperson, Dr. Shetty, for his timeliness and his strict control over the entire situation, as also Dr. Sangeeta Menon once again for scheduling this important lecture during the course of this overall course. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Brigadier Ravindra Kumar. May I now request Dr. Sangeeta to present a memento to ours.